here with Sean Knott right now, and I'm a bit confused because I love 8 out of 10 cats, but sometimes I tune in and it's Countdown instead. Mm. When does it become Countdown and when does it become 8 out of 10 cats?
When we go to Manchester. we go up to Manchester because they record Countdown up there and they've got the Countdown set, which is sacrosanct. It's like they treat it like the Sistine Chapel.
Really?
Once for a laugh, I threw something at the Countdown clock as it was going round.
Ah.
And there was uproar and they said, no, that can't go in the show, and they had to record the bit because I just said I hate the clock, and I threw a bit of paper I put in my mouth and threw it, and it hit the end of the second hand as it was going round. I was really pleased with that. They said, no, you've done something sacrilegious to the Countdown set. So it has to stay in Manchester. We go up there and we record it whenever we're bidden.
Because it's coming, but that's coming back again, isn't it?
Mm. It's very popular, yeah.
Yeah, it is. It's brilliant. Is it?
Well, it is for John and other people, not for me. I just get humiliated week in, week out.
You're not very good at it, are you?
Well, no, it's not that I'm not very good at it. John is a freak. The Dictionary Corner never get more than him.
Yeah.
He's a sort of freak. He's actually got a miniature version of the set in his loft.
I could believe that as well.
Yeah. So he's really good at it. So I go there, I just get beaten over. It's like you're going back for another bit. I feel like Audley Harrison is going back for another beating. But, you know, you have a laugh on the show as well.
Yeah, but it started with a mashup, right?
Yes.
Channel 4, and then no one else has carried on their shows. It was that successful. No. They just thought, we'll just carry on.
Successful. I think because, you know, you're doing something, you're playing a game, and people like to play along. Yeah. And they like to see someone just fail. I think people like to see someone just failing over and over again. There's something about it which reminds us of all our lives. And I become every man. I'm like England and John's Germany. Yeah. And we're just trying to beat them. There was that one time in 66.
And that's it. Right, let's talk about your stand-up then. Well, actually, you say you're a comedian, not stand-up. Is that fair? Is that right?
Well, yeah, I mean, I've always sort of... I always feel like really clarifying the idea that I'm a comedian. That's my main job. That's my main purpose when I set out on stage, is not to... I don't necessarily have any agenda or issues. I might talk about things, but my main purpose is to be a comedian. What I like about stand-up is you can talk about anything you want, however you want, but it's got to be funny. Yeah. And that's the only rule. And I think that's brilliant. I think that's great that you have this rule. There's no other art form that has that other than disco. You know, you are not making a disco record if people are just standing around like that, looking wistfully out of a window. That's not a disco record. And it's disco and comedy are the only two things where you have to have a particular response.
Yeah.
You know, if you can't even think of any others. I mean, jazz is like...
Yeah, I watched X Factor does disco the other day when they had disco songs, and they turned disco songs into ballads, and I was complaining about it on Twitter, saying, this is not disco, you can't dance to this, I want my money back, which is what you're basically saying.
Yeah, disco is a particular discipline.
You're not doing Twitter, are you? You've joined Twitter, but you refuse to do it. Is that right?
I don't do it. A couple of reasons. One is that I don't want to spend my time worrying about it. I mean, once you set it up, you've got to sustain it. And I wouldn't want to do that. And also, I think I'm a very dangerous combination, is me, Twitter, and alcohol.
That's what we want to see, though.
I could ruin my three tweets, my career would be over. I just think you'd be... Because, I mean, I work late, so I have a drink late, and it'd be like 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, and I'll go...
I know what's funny.
I just think it's best if it keep me away from it, and it's not designed for me, really.
Yeah. All right, listen, Purple Band Man. So is there a theme to this?
Not really, as such. It's a stand-up show like I've done in the past, but you've got to come up with the title, and I always thought White Van Man was really patronising, the idea that every man who does a manual job thinks exactly the same.
Yeah.
And then I thought, if you gathered up all my thoughts and opinions, you'd assume I drove a purple van.
Purple van.
Also, you know when you get asked... you're 50 now, aren't you?
Yeah.
We were talking about this earlier. And you get asked, what do you want for Christmas? I always see it as like, oh, that's a pain in the pain question. Like, don't ask me that. It's like, I don't want to spend thinking what I want for Christmas. and it's terrible, really, but I just can't really think of anything. You don't want toys, do you? What do you want for Christmas?
Me, nothing.
Nothing.
You don't want anything, do you?
The thing is, well, no one believes you. I can genuinely say I actually don't want anything for Christmas, and it generally wouldn't bother me if on Christmas morning I had nothing to eat.
It would bother me.
Would it?
I'd be really hurt. you must measure your popularity by the effort people go to.
Yeah.
Your family give you nothing.
Well, they don't. They do. They know they have to give me something, but it's a tough ask for them, because one time my brother bought me juggling balls.
Oh. Right?
He didn't inquire as to my interest in it. And I opened them and I just threw them back at him one by one. It was a tough job, really.
My granddad just used to open everything and go, oh, it's just what I always wanted. Yeah. And one year my mum had swapped the presents, so he had my nan's slippers. He went, oh, just what I always wanted. He never cared about it. So what do you want for Christmas? You got it?
I don't know. I don't know. Bottle of that.
Well, we've had weird things the last couple of weeks. Gareth Malone, for his birthday, he got a meat thermometer and was really excited by that. Mm. And then last week, he was saying they got a mincer.
Maybe just men over the age of maybe 30 just don't buy them presents anymore. Maybe just give them money or something.
No, they don't want that. They want you to think about them, but it's just that... You do. You're quite needy. Still needy.
Yeah. The December shows are going to be really interesting, aren't they, Tim?
Anyway, are you still out touring this, or is it?
I've got a few dates left, about four or five dates left.
And then off for Christmas.
Yes, off for Christmas.
And then when do you start doing another tour? Then have you written one?
Oh, not for a couple of years. I do every 3 years. Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I'll take a. I don't do any for a year. Then I write it for a year. Then I'll do it for a year. I'll do gigs, but I won't do a tour.
Do you still feel blessed that you're? You're doing it because you did do proper jobs, didn't you, at one stage, building?
Yeah, no, I think I'm very lucky, yeah. Yeah, I do, I appreciate that. It was, especially to get into stand-up when I did, because it wasn't as competitive when I started. It's quite competitive now.
Yeah.
No, it's great. It's a great thing to make your living out. I mean, it's full-on when you're doing it, but you get time off.
Brilliant.
Yeah. Can't complain in show business.
No, you can't complain in show business. Thanks, Sean.